Hello and welcome to Talking Baseball. Couple of the big boys dominated this weekend. Studs, Devers, Darvish, Skeens, oh my. Let's talk ball.
Paul Skeens. Sorry.
Carl Ravage busting out the Little League ball on you. Here comes the smoke. Speaking of here comes the smoke, hello and welcome to Talkin' Baseball, presented to you by SeatGeek. Code TALKIN10, 10% off. Trev, BBD, myself, May 20th. Big weekend for sports. Couple NBA teams eliminated, including me and BBD's Knicks. Some good golf this weekend.
Yeah, times are great, Minnesota. What are you talking about?
Yeah, is Ant him? But there was a lot of good baseball played this weekend, and I'm excited to talk it over with you, Trev. How are you?
Jake Biebers, I'm doing great. Again, you're totally right. A lot of sports this weekend, all the major sports, and then I had a lot of youth sports as well, so I got my fill. I had a nice little barbecue last night. Threw a bunch of stuff on the Santa Maria grill. So I smelled like smoke this morning.
Santa Maria!
Just beautiful oak musk on me. I had to take a shower. So I'm back. I'm clean.
Sipping on a
great.
Couple
I look
Modellos?
A little pale.
Couple Modellos by the grill?
Some red wine
okay.
yesterday.
Okay.
Yeah, I kept it classy. Yeah. Not that Modellos not classy, but.
No.
Maybe a few Valencia orange peels. I don't know. How are you, Pop?
I'm good. Had a little bit of a life bender past couple days. Went to like a getaway resort with Jess. They had a little fire pit there, a little like personal Ooh. Fire pit. Forgot how much that like hits my core living in the city. Yeah. That's something you don't get at all.
So true.
So
oh,
I
man.
Yeah. So I you know Jess calls it. It's me and the fire. I've got some Rangers hockey on the phone. Bought a couple beers, didn't know they were 10%ers, so I got at this, like, wellness Ooh. Retreat, got a little tuned up, and then I came back, and I went, had a really cool, like, lifetime backstage at Saturday Night Live with Gyllenhaal and Sabrina Carpenter.
Okay.
Yeah. Shout out to Michael Longfellow. He's a big baseball fan, member of the cast. Awesome dude. Snakes guy. Who's also okay. transitioning to, like, Yanks being in his AL team, so we're kind of ships crossing in the night. And it was also, yeah, Trev, I was kind of saving this for you a little bit, and Beeps. It was the last show, so they had, like, their season-long rap party, too. And, like, dude, it was, like, fucking, like, real famous. Like, John Hamm, chilling.
I watched Top Gun Maverick last night, obviously.
Yeah. And I have a pic. I'll send it to BBD. Maybe we'll save it at the end for the YouTube.
Wow.
I took a pic of Jess just having a good time, and John Hamm is like directly behind her. And I always thought I'd walk in on that one day, but now that I have the picture. So, yeah, it was pretty cool. Sabrina Carpenter, like people are obsessed with her right now, dude.
My friend Sabrina, I caught a first pitch from her. People forget.
What?
Yes.
Time out.
Olivia thought she'd walk in on that one day. No, Sabrina, this was many moons ago. She was still like a very, I mean, maybe not super well known. She's turned into like a full on pop star, but that's awesome, man. I didn't know you did all that.
When did you catch? And then I went to Knicks game 7 just because I like to kind of bottom out and empty a weekend. So yeah.
Holy.
Really
okay.
went through it. In between that, I watched a lot of ball. I was on MLB Network watching Cliff Floyd and Vescursion. Your twin, you got to answer to Guardians fans, Trev.
Yankees, Guardians, this is my nightmare.
Dude, Yankee fans are hot. We got to talk about
Yankee
that a little
hot.
Bit.
I know.
Blue Jay fans are in, they're in a weird spot. We're getting GM quotes. There's Jess and John Hamm.
She's having a great time.
She didn't know. I did when I was taking the picture. I was like, this is going to be funny. She had no idea.
You just told her you were taking a picture.
Oh, no.
You think John Hamm's like, hey, listen, you little, I know what you're doing.
Oh, dude, definitely. Definitely. I felt bad. I had a good exchange with Keenan. I hit him with, I was just like, we were ships crossing in the night. Hit him with like, dude, thank you for so many laughs. And he like appreciated that. Like that was a good quick hitter comment.
Complimenting people usually makes them feel good.
And the other thing, the other thing you'll really like, Sabrina Carpenter, do you know who she's currently dating?
I do not.
Biebs?
I don't believe I do.
Barry Keoghan? I'm not sure if I'm saying the last name right. He's the little freaky guy. Was the Saltburn, the big movie this summer.
He's the freak in that?
Yeah.
Oh, like the ugly, good-looking guy.
The handsome Irish kind of, yeah.
We don't know if he's good-looking. Yeah.
Right, like he's kind of stunning, but it's also like...
I can't stop looking, but yeah. I can't call him hot.
Okay, I know.
So me and him, you know, basically two little freaky alphas staring at each other. We had a nice exchange. Let's talk some fucking baseball.
Let's yuck some ball.
Let's yuck some ball. Enough of us being sluts.
God, you are. For celebs, you are.
Go to SeatGeek. I did that, and I watched the Knicks season end as a part of this weekend. Again, you got to bottom out sometimes. Trev's got a seat. I'm sitting in a seat. Biebs also in a seat. And with code TALKIN10, 10% off any tickets on SeatGeek, whether you're a new customer or not. So if you're going to something, save yourself a couple doll hairs and use it on something else. Or save it. Invest. Bitcoin. We'll get to that. Add code TALKIN10. TALKIN10 at SeatGeek. Download the app. Click the link in the description. Let's talk some ball. My God.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Me and her.
That's crazy. So what year? That's
2017.
2017, yeah.
She's a child there. That's crazy.
She's a child. She's not a child anymore.
No.
She's like a legitimate pop star. I tell Olivia that all the time. It's crazy. Good for her, though. She's had a massive glow up.
She opened for T-Swift. Let's talk baseball. God damn it. We'll do our pop culture show later. Because, Trev, we got to talk about... Could I see this in October? Seattle and Baltimore. Even, the pitching matchups, man. Luis Castillo, Grayson Rodriguez, Kirby and Burns on the final day. Orioles take the series. They have their massive Orioles inning in that first game to start it off. 5 runs in the first. That'll do, pig. Gunnar Henderson leading Major League Baseball in home runs. Okay. Sorry, wasn't that familiar with your power game, friend? Corbin Burns shuts him down on the last day. They get to Kirby enough. The only game Seattle wins, they won with their secret recipe, Trev. Rain. That's what Seattle does. Tampa Bay Rays and the Blue Jays teed it up in some AL East action. And the Rays took the first 2 games. Couple 1-run jobbers. Rays, big 3-run inning in the 6th. Tyler Alexander with a perfect game bid. Johnny DeLuca on the comeback, Trev, in game 2. Your fingerprints are everywhere.
All over, everywhere.
DeLuca, Carpenter, not talking Carey. Trev, Blue Jays, a lot of bigger conversations are happening. They win on the final game to salvage it. Vogie Baum helps out. Romano gets his 7th save of the season, but Paredes hit a 2-runner. I don't know. Some interesting combos. Rays also getting back into the conversation. Trev, show some respect to the Guardian. Oh, dude, you never in the power rankings, dude. How could you?
People are all over us.
And maybe they're rightfully so, because the guard dogs sweep the Twins. A tale of two kitties for the Twins, man. Who are they? They're Jekyll and Hyde. Meanwhile, Cleveland's just been rolling, man. So, guard dogs fans, you guys are right. It's a vibe. He outduels Paddock. David Fry, how's your 3-for-3 and a home run? Tristan McKenzie is dealing. Dude, I watched a Tyler Freeman, mixtape reel of what he's doing defensively.
You can do it.
That's what I like, even more than Sabrina Carpenter's Reddit. Angels, they take 2 out of 3 from the Rangers. They've got some guys popping up. Willie Calhoun with a big night at the stadium, sure. Jose Soriano pumping cheddar. Joe Adell's hitting homers. I don't know, Angel. Kevin Pillar? What year is it? Meme. Rangers took them 13 innings to win that middle game. But they do. What's going on, Texas? Let us know. Let us know. The whole West is looking a little bizarre because guess who's not dead? The Houston Astros. They take 2 out of 3 from the Milwaukee Brewers. Some fun baseball. I mentioned Kyle Tucker. 2-homer night after changing his gear, Trev. What's that about? Baseball players are weird, man. Let's see. Hunter Brown and Freddie Peralta, they both got hit a little bit. Joey Ortiz is putting up some big numbers. How's your Corbin Burns trade return? William Contreras is like an MVP candidate, but it's too much from Houston as they're starting to win some baseball games. Yankees sweep the White Sox. Yep. Juan Soto, he's that guy, pal. Yanks are doing fun things on defense. They're starting pitching. They're going 6 innings. It's Yankee fans are high, Trev. Might have to have you talk me off the ledge. And can I say something? Kansas City Royals. They've just been good, like, all year. They sweep the A's. I know the A's are having a little bit of a bottoming out. But Cole Reagan shoves. Their starting pitching is giving them effort with some star powers like Salvi, Bobby Witt. I don't know. Kansas City deserves a little more love, and maybe we'll give it to them as we get the standings from Trevor Plouffe in the American League.
Unbelievable. I missed that, Pop. I missed the burn there.
You and me need to fight.
I do have the standings.
You and I need to fight soon.
I think that you and I need to have it out in the town.
Yeah.
And then we fight at the end of the night. That's what we need. In the American League. Jacob and Biebers.
Yes.
Your Yankees are 33-15. Congratulations, guys. You're leading the AL East. Baltimore, 2 games back at 29-15. Tampa Bay Rays, over 500, 25-23. And then it's Boston at 23-24. And Toronto at 20-25. And the Central, those Guardians, man, they just win baseball games. And I've been getting yelled at all weekend long on my social media. They're 30-17. The Royals are 29-19, just a game and a half back from those guards. And then Minnesota, great stretch of ball, bad stretch of ball. That's what's happened. 24-22. The Detroit Tigers, little scuffle out there in Arizona.
Couple of our guys.
I know. They might.
We got to break that up, I think.
Yeah, 23-23 for the Tigers, and the White Sox 14-33, and then the West. You mentioned the Mariners. Right now, they would be playoff bound. Jake, 25-22. They're leading the West, and they are the only team over 500 in that division because the Rangers are at 24-24. Houston on the way up, 21-26, and then it's Oakland at 19-30, and the Los Angeles Angels at 18-29.
It's beautiful, Trev.
Things are on the way up for a lot of these teams.
Yeah, man, and I expanded wildcard. We talked about a lot on this program just because there's something to the baseball purist side of it that it's like, you know, we play 162. Why don't, like, that used to be the reward for teams. I'll tell you why they expanded, man. You look at the wild card standings. Like, what's in the AL? This is my first time looking at it. Tampa Bay, who, I don't know, felt like they had a bad start to the season, currently tied with the Twins for the last playoff spot. The Texas Rangers are a game out. Detroit is a game out. The Red Sox are a game and a half. Like, the Astros are 3.5 out. The Blue Jays, teams that we're talking about, like, one of the topics that I think is a good topic to discuss today is like, what are the Blue Jays doing? Do they need to reset this whole thing? And with a quick week, they would be back in the playoffs. So I hate when I leave that personally as a cop out. Like I say, hey, if a team has a hot week, blank, because you could do that basically till August. That I don't know. It's really exciting to me because we're going to talk about how good a couple of these teams are right now, and whether it's injuries or just a bad spell. Like, a lot of these teams' seasons are going to be flipped on their heads. Why don't we go to the Central, Trev? Because one of the topics written down on this sheet are the Jekyll and Hyde twins, and I'd love to get your thoughts on that. And then Cleveland does deserve more love. Like, they're the Brewers of the AL. Like, if you look at, we got tagged with their, you know, their season history. Cleveland runs a good franchise. I know we want a little more. Like, we want that Rhys Hoskins step that kind of we've seen Milwaukee done, and we've given them their flowers. But, dude, I meant Tyler Freeman, what he's been doing. Jimenez has taken another step. Like, Cleveland has been one of the best baseball teams all year.
Yeah, I'd rather talk about Cleveland than Minnesota, to be honest with you. I think people know how I feel about Minnesota. Great stretch of baseball, and then they kind of just ran into a couple of buzzsaws. I mean, the Yankees and the Guardians are playing good baseball, and again, I'd rather kind of just give the Guardians their flowers. I mean, really good at bats off Yoán Duran. That's kind of a topic. I'm doing the pre and post game for the Twins. That's going to be a topic. See, two curveballs got hit. The guy throws 105 miles an hour,
right,
and you're getting pumped on your curveball. So that's interesting. It's been called his best pitch from time to time. But really, you're right. The Guardians are just, since 2013, Jake, because that's the picture you're talking about. Since 2013, they've had two seasons under 500 ball. And, you know, like, we get called out for not giving them enough credit. And I told the person that called us out, I said, you know, one of the reasons is, well, a lot of times it's new faces. So when there's new faces around, you don't have track records. It's hard to really, like, you know, put a identity to a team. They're starting to build a little bit more of a core here. Obviously, J-Ram has been there and been doing his thing for quite some time. But I like the comparison to the Brewers. Because, you know, Bieber gets hurt, Kwan goes out, and you're like, okay, it's probably going to start, you know, coming back down to earth at some point for these Guardians, but they keep finding ways to win. And, like, they're getting the timely hitting, and they're getting, you know, the defense is always kind of there for them. But it's, and we've seen it with the Royals. We've seen it with, honestly, the Phillies have been this way too, and the Guardians. It's a bunch of guys stepping up at, you know, the bottom of the lineup, or, you know, just spread throughout. It's not one or two guys just getting the job done. For them, if you look at the stats, it's like, oh yeah, Josh Naylor's crushing the ball, and, like, he's a big reason why they're there, and he is, but it's these timely hits from, you know, Fry and what he's doing, and Jimenez, and, like, obviously, you know, Ramirez is doing it as well. Like, that's kind of been his MO this season, has been timely hitting. So they, man, I don't know. They're a team you wouldn't want to face in a playoff series. Like, they have kind of a recipe to, you know, stifle the bats. And, like I said, if you're getting those hits with runners in scoring position, like, go Guardians, go, man. 30 wins already? I think we all thought the Central was going to be a good race. And the Twins were going to be maybe at the forefront of it, but I don't think the Twins are that far behind as far as roster construction to the Guardians, and I don't think the Royals are that far behind, and even the Tigers have a chance, although I think offensively they're probably the worst team. But it's going to be a great race all the way through, man. It really is. I don't think any team's going to run away with it.
Man, they are getting an incredible effort out of their bullpen. Go look at Class A's stats if you want to do, like, is this a video game or is this real life? That's a 0.39 ERA. And yeah, I think if we told you the Guardians were going this year, you'd probably be like, well, that young rotation must have taken the step. Like, Bibee is doing his thing. The ERA is a little boosted, but, you know, that can happen. He's throwing innings. Tristan McKenzie is starting to go 3.23 ERA. Like, I don't know. Their hitting is kind of been their strength, and we've talked about Naylor's breakout. Freeman has gone nuts this year. I shouldn't say the hitting's been their strength, and I think what they do year in and year out that I think, again, the Brewers overlap, like, they find guys that can play defense, like, what, run prevention, that's what front offices like to label it, They always have someone who can throw the ball a little bit, except when they shut down their whole rotation in August last year. And it's the things like that that rub us the wrong way. Treb, old school guy, fifth in runs.
Yeah.
That works. That works.
Every time I press Chris Rose about the Guardians, I'm like, okay, Chris, what's going on? Like, you guys are great. How are you feeling? You must be happy. He's like, oh, I don't know. I'm just kind of waiting for the bottom to fall out. Like, we can't keep relying on a guy like David Fry. And then he'll be like, oh, have you seen what David Fry's doing? I'm like, are you giving him enough credit? It's like, I don't know if it's just him or not, but he's the person I talk to the most that's a Guardians fan.
Right.
And he is on that page of like, I don't know, man. Like, it's going to come crashing down at some point. And it's not going to. Like, they're finding ways to win baseball games. And I'll go back to the Brewers reference. Again, we knew as soon as we thought the Brewers were going to be bad, that they were going to be good. Kind of the same way here.
Little schedule check. Guard Dogs have the Mets, Angels, and Rocks coming up. So, like, you keep it rolling, and their record's going to be in a very impressive spot.
David Fry has a one dot.
Sure.
460 OBP through 100 plate appearances, man.
Go off. Okay. Go off, King.
Who was he drafted by? The Brewers.
Look at that. That's called full circle in the biz. Great stuff, Trev. Let's do a little American League bookends. Because, Trev, Yankees... I tell Jimmy this sometimes. He would be the worst poker player in the world if he got into that hobby. But he'd figure it out by the end, and he'd have tells on everyone, and he'd watch videotape, so he'd get good at it. But he's bad at holding in his emotions. He's highest on the Yankees that he's been since the start of Talking Yanks, since the start of John Boy Media, which goes back to 2017. There was the upstart Yankees that were young and fun, and you don't get that in Yankee land. 2019, there's a lot of hope that season, but there's kind of a lot of fluky things happening. 2022, they got off to the great start. That they were like 40-15 at one point, and Rizzo, Judge, like, the Yanks are back. That team had question marks. The Yanks look good, Trev. So I don't know if you want to talk us down, or I think the other thing I stumbled into last night, with Houston not currently looming, like Houston has been, I think that has Yankee fans standing a little taller as well.
You have to be happy. I mean, you guys are doing all of this without Gerrit Cole.
Yeah.
The rotation has just been incredible for you guys. And I think that's, I mean, if I was a Yankee fan, that's what I'd be pointing to most. Like, okay, you have Juan Soto, you have Aaron Judge, Stanton starting to go a little bit. But when you have, I don't know, 5-6 guys that you can rely on once Cole gets back. Like, it's you have a chance to win every single night.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the good feeling. Throw the ball, pitch the ball the way we can. Our offense is going to pop off. We have, you know, generational type hitters back to back in this lineup. I mean, what's not to like? And again, it's makes it even better because the rotation wasn't supposed to necessarily be the strong point of the team. Right, like coming into the season, probably weren't thinking that necessarily when Gerrit Cole's out.
You thought there was a chance with Cole to be really good because, you know, Stroman, Rodon, Nestor, yeah. Those guys have.
But Rodon, you know, coming right off his season, and Stroman first year in New York, and Nestor, what he did last year, was injured a lot of the year. I've talked about this a lot on Baseball Today. Like, there was a lot of question marks.
Yes,
and now there's no question marks, and you get a. You get Gerrit Cole coming back. So, I mean, I'm not talking you guys down anytime soon. I think it's still a long ways to go, but things look great. I'm happy for you.
I'll tell you what. I wonder what I'm saying.
And then I don't want to break hurt your bubble. Okay. It is the White Sox. It is the White Sox. And the Twins ran through them, too. They won like 7 straight against them. So
let me see where we are in a week. These are the next 7 starters the Yankees will be seeing. Logan Gilbert, Brian Wu, Bryce Miller, Luis Castillo, Yu Darvish, Dylan Cease, Joe Musgrove. We'll find out some things in the next week.
We will. I like that.
Yankee fans are feeling good. On the other end of the spectrum in the beautiful AL East, Toronto Blue Jays, we got, you know, the GM's talking to the press, and they are at the bottom of the American League standings, and I think the thing that's scarier, Toronto is some of their, they are 29th in runs. The White Sox are 30th, and if you go look at what the White Sox are doing, you know, they are last year's A's currently. Like, you almost, when you're doing league stats offensively, it almost starts at 29, because they've kind of got the 30th spot locked up. 29th in runs. Vladdy, Bichette. Again, it's this version of the baby Jays we had in our head that they were going to be hitting for the next decade. And now we're sitting 20 and 25. They just lost 2-3 again to the Rays in division, who they're now back in kind of where you expect the Rays to be in the standings. I don't know.
It's interesting. These quotes are interesting to me. Like, what are we doing here? Is this trying to get the clubhouse going? Like, if a GM comes out and says stuff like that, there's a reason for it. Like, so I'm assuming that's what this is. But I mean, yeah, there's been some very unspectacular performances from the Blue Jays this year. You mentioned they're 29th in runs scored. They've given up the 9th most runs in baseball. So, like, that's not a great combination. I think their run differential is third worst in the American League. It's like White Sox and A's, and then it's the Toronto Blue Jays. That's not something we expect out of these guys. I mean, they've kind of like went out and done it. I think the way that you and I like teams to, you know, build a roster, like, you have your homegrown guys, you go out and supplement it with talent, you go and fortify your rotation. And then it just hasn't worked. And, you know, there's reasons for that. I mean, you got Bo Bichette, who's negative war right now. You got George Springer, who's negative war right now. Justin Turner really hasn't done it. I mean, Bo Bichette, 70 OPS plus. Springer, 62 OPS plus. Like, these are guys you're counting on to, you know, lead your offense, and it just hasn't been that way. They've hit 36 homers. That's the third fewest in baseball. It's like, the pop isn't there. Mm. Where would they be without our guy Dalton Varsho? I mean, we've been waiting for them to turn the corner and become this powerhouse team. It just hasn't happened.
Trev, we're going to find out in 10 days. That's the good news, because they have their two series with the White Sox. So the whole wild card speech I gave at the beginning of this episode, that a lot of you teams may be talking yourself into, I mean, it literally, it saved the Twins season. Like, not to be dumb, but it has the Twins still in a fine position. If you're the Blue Jays, if you can go hit for 10 days, put up an 8-10 or an 8-2, you're back. If you don't,
White Sox have been the medicine. They've been the medicine.
It's a good dose. It's a good dose too. Trade Tommy Pham somewhere. He's balling now. Your
they
guy, Tommy.
They could have used Luis Arraez. They could have used Luis Arraez, right?
I thought it was a fit.
He's playing somewhere else now, Jake.
I thought it was a fit. And those Padres, they're feeling pretty good about themselves. We'll get there in a second. Trev, I think the only... There's some high-level AL stuff. I think from this weekend, it was the first series I started with, and it's the other favorite in the AL, Baltimore. Again, some great pitching matchups. A lot of good baseball players on the field when you're looking around. The Orioles, they hold serve, including that last day, Corbin Burns, Kirby. They get to Kirby pretty good. Big part of it, Gunner, which maybe that's where the time should be spent, man. Like, this...
He's a freak, dude.
I've done the overshadowed by Adley on one side and then Holiday on the other side. Like, this is the guy.
No, he's the guy. He's the man. An absolute stud. He'll pump you to right field. He'll pump you to left field. He'll make great plays. Like, he does everything on the field. I tell everybody that, like, is a casual baseball fan. I got guys over last night. We were watching some ball, and I was like, this is... Gunnar Henderson's the guy. Like, he's an absolute freak. I believe it's him and Tucker, 15 homers apiece, leading the league. What can you say, man? I don't know. The Orioles are another one of those teams that they just have so many guys that can beat you. And then you have a guy like him who's been so consistent. It's like you're trying to dodge, you know, all these other landmines. And then here's Gunnar Henderson. You can't miss him. So it's like you're trying to navigate a lineup. I mean, look, I mean, Seattle's pitching is their calling card. Like, these guys are legit, and they got roughed up because Gunnar Henderson wakes, like, first inning, just, I'm going to hit homers. Like, he sets the tone, dude.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's the best way to put it. Like, for the Orioles, he is the tone setter. And like I said, after him, it's like, you just got a bunch of other landmines, and what are you going to do? And this was a great series. Seattle, you know, the offense is always the question mark. I mean, in three games, they scored 9 runs, and like, playing against the Orioles, it's not going to get it done, dude. But yeah, Gunnar he's on a different level, man. And now the Orioles get Grayson Rodriguez back. Like, you got to be scared of them.
Oh, yeah. No, I think the Orioles and the Yankees are the current American League favorites. And it's, you know, do you look at the Yankees as the new Yankees, the team that can't get it done? And they, you know, hey, stop. Don't tell me about the rings, bro. You know, if that's your angle, cool. All right. For the Orioles, it's kind of, you know, the baby birds. They haven't done it in October. That's what they're missing. Those two are the favorites right now. I'm interested to see who emerges from the West. In Seattle, like, I'm doing a head tilt on the YouTube, and make sure you guys subscribe. That'd be cool. Mariners, I'm not bought in yet. It just feels like the exact same Mariners team. You know,
it
feels like we've had the same conversation about the Mariners for 2 years. Like, wow, that pitching, man. But the hitting worries me. So, hey, maybe it's dumb. Like, Julio's going to do his second half thing again. Luke Rayleigh has kind of been balling. That was one of their weird transactions that looks like that might be paying off. So, I don't know, Seattle. I guess tell me, because you guys know your team better than me, does it feel different?
No, it is the same, Jake. I don't think they need to tell us anything. I mean, we're watching the same things they're watching. I mean, you have everything that you need except a guy, maybe two guys, to really fortify the offense. They went out and tried to do things and change their offensive approach. It hasn't worked out. I mean, you can't have your superstar guy who you paid how much money to. He can't have a 655 OPS.
Yeah.
Like, Julio needs to go. Like he has to play. Like, they were banking on him being that guy, being Gunnar Henderson. And then everyone around him do their thing. And he just hasn't done that yet. I mean, that's why I talk about Gunnar Henderson. First game of that series, they're down 1-0. And he pumps a solo homer, gets the lead right back, and they end up scoring 5. Like, that's...
Yeah.
What are you going to do? And all of a sudden, you're Seattle, and pressure's on your offense. You know how that goes. Like, I think that when it's all said and done, at the end of the year, I think Gunnar Henderson might be... I mean, he's going to be like a top 3 MVP guy. Which is, how old is he, 20, 22?
Everything checks out.
It's nuts,
top
man.
Prospect, rookie of the year. We've, like, seen him get better on the fly. Him in that Abe Lincoln... MF-er. Go look at Kyle.
Can you hear about more about them?
Go look at Kyle later. Tucker's stats. 15 home runs.
Can't wear green cleats, bro.
Kyle Tucker's 27. He's got 21 career WAR. He's got 3 WAR in the season. He's one dotting. 7 That's stolen bases, no caught stealings. Kyle Tucker can do everything you ask on a baseball field.
You know who would love Kyle Tucker? The Mariners.
Oh, God.
You need somebody like that, right?
Oh, God. Kyle Tucker would be God in Seattle. People would be dressed as Honest Abe in right field.
They're already saying the Astros aren't going to be able to pay him, so. Not
a lot of people are going to be able to pay this dude. It's my favorite exercise. How much money will Kyle Tucker get paid? He's going to have some weird shit in his basement. Houston, still in the mix. Them and the Brewers, some decent baseball there. I don't know, series-wise, I don't have a lot of other stuff, so if there's something you want to hit quick before we go to the NL.
No, I'm going to hit some of the Brewers in the later half of the show. I mean, snaps to the Royals for taking care of business. Nice start by Lugo and Singer, because that's just what they do. And they're another one of those teams. It's like they got their main guys, but the auxiliary pieces are kind of firing right now, and they look pretty scary, man. Like a very fun, athletic team out there just freaking playing good baseball. So I know it's the A's, and sometimes we skip over those series because you're supposed to do what you're supposed to do. But they look good.
Yeah, Royals, your biggest problem right now is you're getting big brothered. Like if Cleveland didn't exist, we probably would have had a 5-minute Royals rant about how special it is. And Salvi's a sicko. Bobby Witt, the pitching. But Cleveland, we said, Cleveland has like a really good resume the past few years when you zoom out, and the Royals don't. That's where they're getting hurt right now.
Cole Reagans is a freak. Yeah, I mean, look at their rotation. I'm looking at all the numbers right now. This is probably more surprising than the Yankees rotation. I mean, Lugo 179, Singer 2.7, Reagans a 3.7, Alec Marsh a 2.43 through 7 starts. Like, okay. Here we go.
Royals, how about it? That's the beauty of a baseball season. Excited to see how much we talk about them the rest of the way. And the same with you, Houston. You're getting a little more convo in a bit. Let's talk some National League ball.
Let's do it.
In the National League, how about them Pirates? And how about Paul Skeens, man? Someone texted me, am I watching the best pitcher I've ever seen? Dramatic. But he's got people wondering, and the fact that you got people wondering is because you went 6 innings, 0 hits, 1 walk, 11 Ks. A guy who's pitching better than anyone ever is also Shota Imanaga. That's the only game they win, and it's a controversial walk-off, Trev. Belly? Was he out? Kinda. 1-0 game. Otherwise, it was all Pirates, a couple one-run games. Our guy Jared Jones is still twirling the pill. Pirates kind of have a hitting problem that when they get Triolo or Nick Gonzalez or Sawinski, they've got a chance to win. Interested to see if they turn it around or the Reds, who they win the first game. Little Brett Suter opener. How's your lefties? And the Reds win that game 7-2. They beat Glass now. Ellie's a star. Is he going to steal 100? The Reds lose the next 3. Walker Buehler, 6 inning shut piece. Yep. What does that mean for this season? Andy Páez, man. He hits the 2-run homer, and Shohei walks them off. The Dodgers win 3 out of 4. Reds, Pirates, is anyone gonna? We'll talk about that. The Padres, they currently have taken 2 from the Atlanta Braves. They're going to tee up a doubleheader today. But the Padres have won the first 2, and they've shut down the Braves' offense. Yu Darvish, oh my. Yu is twirling the pill since he's been back. He's just refusing to give up runs. 4 straight starts. Matt Waldron, how's your 10 punchies? How's your knuckler? Padre fans are feeling good.
Yes, they are.
Interesting. Interesting. And let's see what happens with the double dick today. Phillies sweep the Nats, because that's just what the Phillies have been doing. Zach Wheeler.
Their schedule.
They beat another bad team. Nats have punch, but not today. Aaron Nola, 7 innings, 2 earned runs. Christopher Sanchez, 7 innings, 2 earned runs. Hey, Cody Clemens. Look at him joining the party. 1 dot in. Impact. Nice, nice word, Jake. Marlins and Mets played. It's 2 out of 3 for the Fish. Jolly Olive not happy with me at the water cooler this morning. Because I think all the Yankee fans are happy and the Mets are currently not. How's your Otto Lopez walk-off? Trev's going to break that down for you in a minute. Tigers take 2 out of 3 from the Snakes. Like we talked about, a little testy. Tori, yeah. Jack, yeah. Couple alphas.
Can't have that.
Couple alphas. We got a... I think the Jimmy breakdown coming? We'll see. Tigers, they won the first two. 13-0 in that first game. Javi Baez with a couple big games. And Scooble, kind of living up to some Cy Young expectations. D-backs salvaged the last game. Ryan Thompson holds on. A nice relay throw. We love that. We need more relay throws in baseball.
Love relay throws.
I'll talk to Uncle Rob about that next time I get his ear. Tigers win 2 out of 3. Cardinals take 2 out of 3 from the Sox. They won the first two games. Cardinals, are you going to get in the mix this year? I don't know, but they've had an offense problem. And Lars Nootbaar with a couple big games. Nolan Gorman, like, that's what they're going to need to get back involved. Sox, they salvage it on the last day. And Rafael Devers, welcome back to the conversation, man. 5 straight games with a ding-donger. Rockies, they face off with the Giants. And the Giants sweep. And, hey, congrats, Giants.
Are the Giants going to go?
Are they clicking? Hey, Rockies were hot coming into this series, so good for them. Jung-Hoo Lee news. How much does that stink? Unless you're Luis Matos, who goes off after getting recalled up. And that's what happened in the National League. Oh, Sabrina!
Okay, relax a little bit. I do have the standings up. I just have to find my page. Here they are. Yeah. Great job, Poppy. Great Thank job, you. Poppy. John Hamm. In the NL East, those Phillies, they only beat bad teams. Well, they've beaten a lot of bad teams because they lead all of baseball in wins. They're 34 and 14th. Atlanta, 5 games back right now at 26 and 16. And then it's everybody else in the division. 21 and 25 for the Mets, 20 and 25 for the Nationals, and 15 and 33 for the Miami Marlins. They used to be called the Florida Marlins. People forget that. In the Central, Milwaukee, 27 and 19, 2 games above those Cubbies, who are 26 and 22. The Pirates, 22 and 26. St. Louis, kind of making a little charge here, 20 and 26. And the Reds at the bottom of the barrel at 19 and 28. And then in the West, those Dodgers, who they just beat everybody, 32 and 17, except for the Padres, who are 24 and 24. That was a nice little segue by me right there. Sick. The Giants with the sweep, 2 games under 500 now, 23 and 25. Your Snakes, 22 and 25. And then the Rockies at 15 and 31. And those are the standings in the National League.
It's great stuff, Trev. Great stuff. That was all. The standings were brought to you by Tommy John's, which for the YouTubers, that means, you know, I'm going to be showing my boxers in a second. Trev's Tommy John. It's the favorite TJ in baseball. This is the TJ you want. Again, I don't need the script because I wear them every day. If you listen to the show, you already know. This isn't BS, people. I am Jake. I am unfortunately Jake. When I see people in the real world, they say, oh my, I can't believe you're actually like wired that way. A little fucked up. But
they're not wrong.
I made an adult decision. I was like, these are the best underwear I've ever worn. I want to wear them every day. So that's what I did. I ordered a bunch of Tommy John. That's what touches this skin. And you should give it a shot. How about that? Especially if you get 30% off site-wide right now at TommyJohn.com/talking. TommyJohn.com/talking. They have a best pair you'll ever wear or it's free guarantee. Okay. I mean, that's kind of a big flex. Go click the link in the description. Make an adult. You're going to be so happy when you order Tommy John and then like 3 days from now you have fresh underwear. That's such a good feeling in life. Go do it. Tommy John, the absolute best.
They also have like other stuff like sleepwear. I'm not like a big sleepwear guy. You have them? Can I see? Yeah, there they are. But they sent me a pair of shorts and a shirt. And every once in a while, like I'm like, hey, it's a little cold. I'm gonna get into bed with a shirt on. I usually take it off in the middle of the night as Olivia's just trying to get at me all the time. But it's nice to start there. And then I was looking. Let me just ask people this.
Right.
Does anybody wear like actual underwear anymore? Like boxer briefs. It's kind of what everyone wears, right?
Yeah.
That's what I wear. That's what you wear.
I wear the Tommy John boxer. I show them on camera regularly, yes.
But like the underwear-shaped underwear, who's rocking those anymore?
What do you mean? Like whitey tighties? Is that what you're referencing?
Yes, but like they'd have them in like all their beautiful colors and fabrics, like the cut of that. Yes, like it looks like a woman's bathing suit bottom, but for guys, that
right.
form of underwear. Is anybody rocking that anymore?
I mean, tighty whities are kind of out. They've kind of been out ever since.
Beavers, are you briefs?
I'm a Tommy John man.
But what cut do you wear of underwear? Do you wear boxer briefs or do you wear like
the boxer brief? Yeah.
Yeah. No, I.
You guys know what I'm talking
about? Yes. No, I think there's.
I don't think I've ever worn tighty whities.
I think tighty whities are out. I think that cut of underwear, if a guy rocked, like if a guy really owned a pair, I think it could be a flex. Like it's a little European, like you're showing a little more skin on the beach. But yeah, okay. No, that's kind of out.
I'm just curious. I don't
yeah,
know.
Yeah. Sound off in the comments.
Tell us all about your undies.
Trev, how about this? Cubbies and Brewers have kind of established themselves atop the NL Central. We talked a lot of NL Central because it's a fun convo. One of these three teams is going to figure it out. And I don't know which one. Going back to the wild card standings are hilarious. The San Francisco Giants, whose season has felt like a disappointment, they're a game out of the playoffs.
Yes.
With a 4-game win streak. The Snakes, whose season has felt pretty much off kilter the whole way, they're a game and a half out. The Pirates are 2 games out of the wild card. And they've got some juice right now. Juice is a real thing. They need guys to hit. So does Cincinnati. So does St. Louis. I think one of them's going to happen, dude, and I don't know. I almost was going to do this as my award, and I was going to call it the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, because the Cardinals kind of have the names on the wardrobe. Ellie's kind of a witch.
Love that freaking book.
I love the three words. Like, I don't even remember the book at all, but I reference it a lot.
Gosh, what's the lion's name? Asgard? Or?
Yeah.
Anyways, I kind of want to talk Pirates because this is interesting to me. You mentioned they're close to a wild card. I believe they're, what are they sitting right now? 22 and 26. Is that what I said? 22 and 26. But you have a guy like Paul Skeens come up who is Aslan. Thank you for that. Aslan, the lion.
Did you just call me?
Yeah. You have a guy like Paul Skeens come up, and I know it's 2 starts in, people, but like if you watch this guy pitch, you understand like this, he's not going anywhere. He is the deception, the stuff, everything is there. I mean, 6 innings pitch, 11 Ks, no hits, facing a team for the second time in 5 days. I did this on a broadcast for the Twins. There are stats that say historically, the ERA jumps up a quarter of a run when you're facing a team after 5 days. And Chris Rose asked me that question before his second start. He goes, what is Paul Skeens going to do? I said, he's going to be better because his first start, you're nervous. The ball feels weird in your hands. Like it doesn't matter who you are. I know Paul Skeens is big badass dude who like doesn't fear anything, but I promise you, like you get out there first time in the big leagues, like things are a little bit different. Second time in, he feels a little bit more comfortable. This is what happened. So now you got a 3-headed monster, really, in the rotation. What are you going to do as an organization? You know that you need to go add some offense. Are they going to do that? Are they going to allow Skeens and Jared Jones to pitch the rest of the year? Like, what's the plan there? Like, you have the makings of a core. Now, what are you going to do to supplement it? Because we have the expanded playoffs now. You are in the thick of things, even though you have a losing record. Like, you're going to get better because you have these guys throwing the ball for you. Like, what are you going to do as an organization? What are you going to do? Like, that's one of the storylines for me to follow throughout the summer is what are you doing, Pirates? Like, you can't be selling and you can't stand pat. You, like, almost have to go add, right? Or you're just going to shut these guys down. You're going to give them a taste, and it's going to be great, and you're going to shut them down at the end of the year. I don't know. I'm not sure exactly which way they're going to go. I guess Pirate fans let us know if that's been out in the media or anything, but they're one of, if not the most interesting teams in the league to me right now because of these guys they have throwing the ball for them. Skeens is a fucking menace.
I'm so excited to see the next steps. And yeah, Pirates, I don't know. It's an interesting question, Trev, because they need offense. They need offense. So if they add, but you can't add like rentals. So they're 22 and 26 right now. So you wonder if there's a long, like a 2.5 year guy out there that they can say you can be a part of our core. But, you know, we talk about cores in baseball, like the Toronto conversation from a minute ago, it can happen oddly quick. So when you've got a little bit of lightning right now with this pitching staff, you'd love to see them. All three of these teams need to hit. Some of the Red stats are atrocious. And Ellie De La Cruz is one of the breakout stars of the year. But McClain was so huge for them. Friedel, Encarnacion Strand, all three of those guys are hurt right now. Mike Ford's in the middle of their lineup, which not to be a knock on Mike Ford, but he's been like a vagabond around the league. When you're really hunting for offense, Mike Ford gets thrown in your lineup. Yankees, Mariners, Reds. I don't know. Seeing the Cardinals hit this weekend, one of these teams is going to be a 500 team, and that means you're a part of the season. I just don't know which one.
I'm looking at the Pirates' rankings right now, their offensive rankings, and 26 in average, 26 in OEP, 27 in OPS, 24th in runs scored. Their bullpen hasn't been great either. So, like, but these are all things you can address throughout the season. I mean, the bullpen help is readily available during the year. Like, there's always guys that always, there's always teams wanting to capitalize on a guy having a good year in the bullpen. So, you know, go do that. And then, yeah, you had, I'm trying to think of like a good offensive fit for them. Really, it's like anybody, just like anybody that can drive in runs.
I've got him. I just stumbled into something.
Okay.
You know, I know I just said no rentals. What about a little homecoming for Josh Bell? Run it back. Put him at first base. That. It's a guy you know. Like, what's his price tag right now? And it's what you and Jimmy talked a little bit. It's what we've been trying to bring. Like, trade now. Like, imagine if you're the Pittsburgh Pirates. You just called up Paul Skeens. You just added a guy who has the chance to be a premier pitcher in baseball this year. That does something to a clubhouse. If your front office went out and got you a Josh Bell right now for a 19-year-old in low A, God, that would change the juice, man.
Jazz Chisholm, Josh Bell package. Go.
I don't know about all that.
Why? Why not?
Why not?
I think that'd be great for them. You know the Marlins are going to be selling. Who's on the White Sox that's going to be sold?
I don't know. Could Andrew Vaughn use a change of scenery? Eloy? It's tough because if you're the Pirates, I don't know.
Come on, Pirates?
I don't know what their front office thinks their timeline is, but having Jared Jones and Skeens in the majors throwing bullets means the timeline's begun.
Don't forget about Mitch.
You know I don't forget about Mitch. Okay. That got a little H. Let's see,
what's
Trev.
H mean?
What's that?
Heavy?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. It's a heavy combo, all right. Let's see. I mean, there's a lot of good action, I guess. Topic-wise,
Padres Atlanta is in an amazing series, but we only got two games out of the field.
I know. They're
going to watch what happens tonight. Padres going off. They are feeling themselves. Yu Darvish. Are we talking about him later? I don't think anyone's talking about him later. Congrats. 200 combined wins. He's been freaking absolutely nasty. I like the Padres a lot, dude.
Okay.
I found
how I wanted to do this. Of the teams that are kind of in the 500 range, like, you know, I'm looking in the AL, the Texas Rangers, the defending champs. You know, Tampa has kind of climbed up slightly above that. Your Twins, we talked about, they're hot and cold. Like, even if you want to throw Giants, D-backs. Of the 500 teams, are the Padres the best right now? Is that why Padre fans are feeling kind of good?
Okay, I'm looking now. As currently constructed, I think so. Like Texas getting back some pitching will be awesome for them. I think they have the potential, obviously, to go on massive runs with the offense that they have. And what's Seager doing right now? I don't think he's
okay.
Looking this up right now. Is as bad as I thought. 709 OPS. Like that's not going to be there. Throughout the year. So climbing. Like he's going to go. I would say probably Padres, Rangers for that 500. Kind of crew. I'm just a big believer in the Padres. I think they kind of have the formula, man. Like they really, really do. I think there's some teams we talk about, like the moxie and the attitude of the team, and we use it against them. I think that their attitude kind of suits them well this year for some reason. And you have the superstars and you have the guys that are, you know, giving them great seasons as well, like Profar and Merrill. You're getting the pitching. Like it's all there for them. It's just go out and win baseball games, get into the playoffs and go. Like this is, to me, they're a playoff team. And I think we got asked that. I think we talked about that not too long ago, like Snakes or Padres, who do you believe in more this year? And I think the Padres have won me over in that regard big time.
Yeah. You wonder how much we're letting the Arias trade affect us. But the vibes just feel a little different, and vibes actually matter. I think that's something we talk about on Talking Baseball, but at the same time, like I'm so scared they're playing the Braves for two today. Like we could wake up tomorrow and it's Braves won two ball games, Padres two games under. But I don't know. I mean, what Profar's been all year is insane. Darvish. Yeah, I don't know. If baseball had a midseason tournament like the NBA added, I think the Padres would be like our sexy pick right now.
Ooh, I like that.
Yeah.
Eighth in OPS, seventh in runs. They're hitting homers. They're stealing bags. So offensively, they're getting the job done. I mean, like this is there. I know they've made moves already, many moves already, but you expect more out of them because that's just what Preller does. I'm in on this team. Big time.
Hey, I'll say something that'll maybe ruffle feathers.
Okay.
You Darvish Hall of Fame? Like, it's a baseball Hall of Fame. It's not just major leagues. And, like, what, 200 professional wins?
I think it is the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame, I think.
Pro Baseball Hall of Fame? I don't know. I'll double check that because then I could be wrong.
Yeah, I don't think like the Japanese stars are in the Hall of Fame.
It's the National Baseball Hall of Fame. What's national mean?
What does national mean? I think it means of the nation, national, I believe. Like that's what it means.
No Blue Jays allowed.
Okay, I'm looking at the career numbers now. This is a nice little exercise here. He's got 12 years, 107 wins. The wins thing is whatever. I mean, that used to get you Hall of Fame strikeouts. We are at almost 2,000, 1975. He's got, how many more years does he have on his contract? A lot.
He re-upped, dude. Like
at least four.
He's right on the books till 2028.
I'm going to say like no, but I don't know, man. I actually don't. My barometer on like what a starting pitcher needs to do to get in the Hall of Fame is, I don't know. I haven't paid attention to that, I guess. I know it's like 3,000 strikeouts. The 300 wins will never happen again. What else do you need to do as a starting pitcher? Like I know the benchmarks for a hitter. What are the benchmarks for a pitcher? Did I just mention both of them?
Yeah, for me, if we allow his history overseas where he had 164 starts and had a 1.99 ERA. Like, I don't know if you, Darvish, had pitched a couple of those years over here.
I don't think you add that into it. You don't do that.
It's the National Baseball Hall of Fame. America's pastime, you.
275 games started here in the States.
Just keep throwing it, man.
I mean, whatever.
Force the issue. Good socials guy. Do you text Jack Flaherty at all?
I didn't. I was going to do it and say, what the fuck is going on out there? Then I kind of read up more about it. It was a very interesting thing for them. First off, shout out Tigers taking the series. Good for them. But the more and more I read about it, the more and more I'm like, I'm on Jack's side. And like, Torrey had some quotes about it. Like, he said that I could handle one thing, but this was more than one thing. And like, okay, what was the other things? Was Jack just looking at you wrong? Was he talking shit about other stuff? Like, basically, if you didn't see what happened, Jack's pitching, you know, I'm actually shocked this doesn't happen more often in the big leagues, but yeah. The mound is a thing. Like, you start to dig into the mound with your cleats and you create holes. And apparently Zach Gallen, it was his home field, didn't like the holes that Jack was, you know, making with his cleats. So every single inning he was having the grounds crew fill those holes and tamp it down. And then something happened. I don't know. They came back and that, I don't know what inning it was, but it was against Gallen and Mantiply. The Tigers take the lead. And then it's this, what you're seeing on the screen right now. Bannister with those tatted up Bannister.
Yeah, I'm not fighting Jeff Bannister.
No, I played for him.
Holy smokes.
Spring training, no big deal.
Right.
I've seen him in the he's a guy. I liked him a lot, actually. He was like exactly like I liked him as a manager. Like, he was stern and like I liked it. But this, yeah, Jack after the game was like, I've never had anybody complain about my mound before. Like, I don't know what was different about today.
Right.
Like, and he's like, I don't care. He can change the mound and whatever he wants. Like, what, you know? So I honestly, I guess I should text him and try to get to the bottom of it. Or you can text Torrey and get to the bottom of it. And then we'll see whose story, how they add up together.
Maybe we'll do our own kangaroo court.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. The pitching mound thing is interesting. Cause I was debating if we should do it as a topic, but, Sixto Sanchez, remember the ace of the Marlins who went missing for 4 years and now he's back. Sixto Sanchez currently has a 1980 ERA. That's not a year. 19.80 ERA in the first inning. A 1.88 in every other inning. So
okay.
I was going to ask about like pitching, first inning nightmares. Could we see this sometimes? And I think the answer is usually it's just like getting adjusted to the mound and what stuff you have that year. And you're facing the best hitters. I do think that matters. But yeah, I'm surprised there aren't more pitcher fights. Cause if you don't like a hole, it can be uncomfortable.
Well, it's supposed to be, you're not supposed to have big holes. Essentially, like, that's kind of the answer here. Like, if the grounds crew is taking care of business and like the mound is doing or is laid the way it's supposed to. Oh my gosh, I'm getting a little double entendre here. If the clay is right, like, you shouldn't be getting big holes, essentially. And I guess that's what was going on here. So shout out the grounds crew, like, or maybe Jack Flaherty just got big old feet, big heavy feet or something. I don't know.
Jack Flaherty has heavy feet.
John Hamm, Jack Flaherty. What do they have? Whew.
Sound off in the comments. Couple other just quick hitter notes from me. Well, A, James Outman gets sent down for the Dodgers. Baseball comes at you fast, man. Crazy with the year he looked together. Here's Andy Páez.
Yep.
Reds note, if you're someone who's got a little red stock, which you know I do, 1-11 in one-run games this year. That's, you know, can that change or can that not change? What was the other thing that jumped out to me? I like Devers going nuts. Like, Devers used to be in the conversation of best young hitters in baseball, and I feel with the Red Sox fading and he had a tough second half, those combos kind of left. So him going nuts, I like to see that.
Nice to see the Cardinals also put up some offensive numbers. That's what they've been lacking all season long. Here they go. You know, you can't hold those guys down. I guess they did last year, a full season, but got to keep going. I can't say like you've totally changed things over the last two series. I need to see more of it.
Yeah.
This is a good series win against a good baseball team in the Boston Red Sox.
Hey, you guys called out Katie Wu for saying that, the Cardinals might have turned the corner. Maybe they're turning the corner.
Katie Boo was just hesitant to say it. It's just like I am too. Like, hey, we need to see more out of these Cardinals. I mean, again, I picked them to win the NL Central. Did we declare them dead?
Ooh. I don't think so.
Or did we declare the White Sox dead?
I think
White Sox are the only ones who've gotten.
I think I announced I'm over the Cardinals until they show me a winning product, because I haven't seen that in a couple years. So I can't just look at the jerseys. Remember the line, the witch, the wardrobe was the Cardinals, because some of those names on the jerseys, bro. I like those names, but they need to show me a winning brand of baseball before I can get into them at all.
Okay. That's fair enough.
Fair guy.
Mets, Marlins, the Diaz situation. You don't want to talk about that?
I do. I'm sorry. I don't know, man.
Again, that was tough.
I'd love, if I'm being real, which that's when we're at our best.
Yeah.
I'd love to do an hour and a half show on guys being sad in the locker room. Because I know it's a topic you and I have discussed a little bit, but just like real feelings, man. Like grown men in a locker room, playing for a career, playing for a family. Now, Edwin, you know, he's got the contract. He doesn't have to worry about some of that stuff. But, you know, this is a guy that started crying in his press conference. Like, that's tough, man.
I think you think about it as this. You wasted a whole season last year. Like, it got taken away from you, and that sucks. And then this year you come, and, like, the team is not doing great, and you're struggling, and I think a lot of it is built up from last year. Like, there's a lot of this, like, hey, man, I wanted to come back and just be the guy that I was. Hasn't been that way for him. I believe they did announce, like, they're going to put him in some, like, more low-leverage situations until he figures it out. Jolly Olive is saying, can we do an Alec Manoah type thing and send him? Or did he say Alec Manoah or Jose Abreu? Either one, not categories you want to be put in with your, you know, all-star closer. We don't need to talk about feelings, but he hasn't got the job done, man. It's the life of a reliever is so volatile, save a few, man. Like, if he hadn't have put up the numbers he did in 2022, the 2022 or 2021, where he was just absolutely lights out. I think it was 2022. We'd be saying he's a reliever, man. Like, things like this happen from time to time. You have really bad stretches as a reliever. Like, it's such a volatile position. I do feel bad for him. I do.
I
think both Diaz brothers got roughed up this weekend.
I still remember. This is going to be a little lame, so I'll Jake-ify it a little bit. One of the funnier stories of John Boy Media is when we brought on Jerry Blevins, asked Peter Moylan. I was like, hey, you know Jerry? Like, is this a guy we should bring in the mix? And he was like, one of the best people you'll meet, awesome dude, blah, blah, blah. 6 months later, in Arizona or whenever it was, we did the spring training house. Peter introduced himself to Jerry. They hadn't met before. And Peter, like, vouched for him like they were in the same battalion. And it's relievers, dude. Relievers are united because it's a brutal life, man. Like, we've done this a couple times, but I want everyone to actually think about it. You come in for one inning. A, is there a hole on the mound? That's something. B, if you're bad in that first inning, which starting pitchers get a game to figure it out, if you're bad in that one inning, you might have lost your team the game. And hey, we might need you the next day. If you're sore, you're not feeling so hot. I mean, that's Peter Moylan was like, dude, picture me. I'm like an Australian doing anything to hang on in this league. Hey, you need me to throw today? Yeah, my arm feels like it's going to fucking fall off, but I'll give you an inning, Skip. Like, reliever life, when you actually dive in, man, it's kind of gnarly.
Yeah, and if you do your job and you take three innings, you bulk and you do your job, but you can't pitch because you just threw three innings, they might send you down.
Right.
We're doing your job. It's a tough business. The Mets, man. You got Steve Cohen coming out and tweeting and deleting, talking about that. And then I think they've lost a lot of games. What are they, like, 7 out of the last 10 games or something like that?
All right, standout performance.
Hey, what about Pete Alonso?
Oh,
going to the Pirates rental.
Oh God.
Okay.
That drop was brought to you by the Farmer's Dog. Hey, I've got a dog, Noodle, and he gets sent the Farmer's Dog once a month, and it's his favorite day. Yeah. Maybe it's twice a month. He eats a lot.
Big dog.
Quit the kibble, kick the can, feed your dogs food that's actually food. Farmer's Dog is developed with vets, made fresh, real meat and veggies portion for your dog. There's old dogs, there's young dogs, there's big dogs, there's little dogs. It's like Dr. Seuss with dogs. That Farmer's Dog gets the food for your dog. And it's the pre-portioned packages. Easy. Your dog will love it. And take care of your dog's health. Young or old, thefarmersdog.com/talking. How about a deal? 50% off your first box and free shipping. Great time to give them a try. Click the link in the description and go check out the Farmer's Dog and go check out Standout Performances. Where are you going, Popo?
This has been like a sad episode. So like an emotional, sad episode. So I'm going to go with something like that made me feel good.
Okay.
How about Walker Buehler?
Okay.
Six innings pitched, 3 hits, no earned runs, 7 Ks, gets the W. It's his first W in like 2 years. He talked about it after the game. Second Tommy John. You know, that's a long time to be on the shelf, working your way back and getting that first victory at home, kind of like feeling like yourself again, has to feel so good. And, you know, I know that we always call him the Moxie King. He doesn't give a shit about anything, but like this is more of like the humanizing effect. Like he's been through some shit. The IL sucks. Tommy John sucks. Rehabbing sucks. Walker Buehler does not suck, and I'm happy to see him back. Like, the Dodgers needed another toy. Here he comes. But I'm just happy, man. When you see a guy go through all that, finally get his first win, and pitch the way he did, oh, it's cool to see. It got me a little bit emotional.
Yeah, it's when you start dreaming of this Dodgers team come the end of the year, you know, Walker Buehler, Moxie King, what does he look like at the end of the year? And this was a big start.
Can I do one more?
Yeah.
Just real quick.
Oh, wow.
So,
okay.
Love that. Shota Imanaga.
Yeah, dude.
The numbers on the year, you're not doing him as an award, are you?
No.
Okay. 5-0, 0.84. He's 53 2/3 innings pitched. He's got a 0.9 whip. This guy has just been out of this world, Jake. Out of this world. I'm so excited for them. And the freaking Cubs, man. Team options, 26, 27, 28 on this.
Right? Game. God, I'd love to see our clips of that, the Shota signing. Like, oh, he's probably not good if he didn't get paid. Brr, he don't throw hard. Brr. Just historically good.
Okay, there's a player option.
When you talk about Moxie King.
We need to get into this contract now because I thought it said just play a team option, but there's also a player option. So I guess it's a mutual option. So it's only 2 years.
Maybe it's one of those.
They can opt in for 4, but if they don't, he can opt in for 2.
Yeah.
I'll look into it.
$20 million team option, $15 million player option.
Which one was more money?
Team.
So that was, if Shota's good, he declines his player option, but the Cubs can opt in and pay him more.
Team can unlock a $57 million club option after 2025, which would be 20 mil, 20 mil, 17. If declined, the player can exercise a $15 million player option for 26. If the 2026 team options, so they can do this again, and the player can unlock a $42 million, no, if 2026 team option is declined, but player exercise, the team then gets another chance to re-up the next year, $42 million, which would be 24, then 18. And if that's declined, the player can do 15 again.
Hey, can I ask a dumb question?
And he has Cy Young escalators and Rookie of the Year escalators.
Who's the last dude that's come over from Japan and has been bunt? Here's
like pitcher or hitter?
Here's a Here's a current list of Japanese players in the MLB. This is from Nippon.com in Japan. Yusei Kikuchi, been better. Like,
yeah.
Definitely not bad.
No. Yoshida, Kenta Maeda, Kodai Senga. Fuji is the only guy that's like whatever, but he was supposed to be kind of whatever. Like, that was the whole...
And the stuff is still cool.
He pitched playoff innings?
Somebody will solve that.
Seiya Suzuki, Shota Imanaga, Shohei Ohtani, Yamamoto, Yu Darvish, Yuki Matsui.
I'm thinking it might be Nishioka. Tsuyoshi Nishioka, who stole my number. 2011-2012 had a negative 2.3 war. He was like a god in Japan. Came over, just wasn't. He wasn't for the American game.
Mm, how about that? Yeah, I'm glad you shouted out Shota. Because, again, it's historic, and, like, we mention that, and then we kind of move on sometimes, so you don't mention it for another couple weeks. And, like, he deserves the love, and good for Walker Buehler. Walker Buehler. Trev, I'm going to go Kyle Tucker.
Okay.
I think 0-for-3 punchies. Changes the arm sleeve and the cleats, obviously, mid-game.
He's not a green cleat guy.
Dude, Kyle Tucker's
flashy. Be yourself.
Kyle Tucker's whatever he wants to be, man. You want a stolen base? You want defense? You want a throw? You want the
most?
Sometimes
you got to take a chance, right, I guess?
You want the most homers in the American League? He led an RBI last year. Like, Kyle Tucker, man, he has 3 WAR. He's one of the best players in the American League. Again. He does this year in, year out. He's like outfields Jose Ramirez. And again, I looked at the wild card standings for the first time this year. The Houston Astros, who've been kind of all-time bad for them, or at least recently, you know, 3.5 games out of a wild card. There's a lot of baseball to be played. And that Astros offense has been humming, and now Verlander's been like, Kyle Tucker's really good. This is my twice a year Kyle Tucker's really good speech. Better than you think.
He's from the skateboard capital of the world, Tampa, Florida.
Sure is.
No.
HB Plant High. Same high school, yes. I think, Wade Boggs.
I love that for you.
Yeah.
Love that for you.
Yeah. Tampa roots.
Here's his OPSs, OPS pluses, excuse me, since he had, let's just give him his first full season in 2021, 147, 129, 144, and this year it's at 197. He's a good player.
27 years old.
Free agent after next year.
Yeah. It's a big number.
Isn't that crazy? Think about this. Think about this.
Here we go.
This guy's been all world, right? A stud.
Yeah.
Absolutely awesome. And I'm not saying this is going to happen. I'm just saying it could be anybody. But let's say he goes out and has like a bad year next year, or like maybe gets hurt.
Right.
I don't even know where I was going with that.
No,
like you got to do it again next year to really maximize his pay. This is what I'm essentially saying. It's crazy. As good as he's been, you still
like
got to do
it.
Next
year was just bad.
To get to free agency is hard, man, in the big leagues. And to hit free agency and have year after year after year after year of success is even harder. He's about to do it.
If the players' union could figure out a way to get in contracts to allow guys to opt out a year before their free agency, I've dreamt this on the show before. I don't know. You'd need teams to get reimbursed with it, with either draft picks or something. But like, okay, if Kyle Tucker keeps this pace up this year, and he like won dots, he finished 5th in the MVP last year. Let's say he finishes 3rd this year. If he had some sort of like opt out of
now,
hit free agency now button, like he would be guaranteed like almost $300 million. I don't know. And you're right. Like he can, I'd hate to say this as a verb, a noun, Michael Conforto, Like, go look up at his years leading up to free agency. If he has another nine-dot year, he has hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars. He's been doing, like, kind of one-year opt-out deals.
It's never going to happen because what they would say is, hey, can we have money back if you play poorly?
Yeah. Mm. It's a tough count.
Can we eject this contract?
If it could not hit,
you're out. You're out of the Players Association.
That would be
if teams could take it off their books.
Like it's a luxury tax, but the player still gets the actual dollars.
Because he can't
every 5 years amnesty.
Can't take money out of guys' pockets. Guys hate that.
It's not time to talk CBA. Just
no,
yet, okay?
No.
We've got a couple years.
We're in the.
Do you know what
place.
Time it is though?
I sure do. Best part of the show.
Dirt nasties on fuego. That means I'm on fire, baby. Like Waco.
I might have partaken in some Nameless last night. Mm. Just saying. As I was watching Maverick. Anyways, for the series, I mean, for life, Gunnar Henderson, 5-for-12, 3 homers, 4 runs driven in. So a lot of solo homers there. For the 1.833 in the 3-game series against Seattle, Jake Myers. Jake Myers,
right here.
7-for-12, a double, 2 homers, 5 runs driven in. He also got hit by a pitch for a 1.7. That was against Milwaukee. How about Javi Baez? We mentioned him. Had a good series, 8-for-13. That's a .615 batting average, 4 doubles. He had 7 runs driven in. Here's how good Javi Baez in this series. He entered the series with a .167 average and a .422 OPS after the series, Jake. He got over the Mendoza line, .209 average and a .524 OPS. So he raised his OPS over 100 points in one series. It's still that time of year, people. Mm. Still that time of year. And Matt Chapman, who I was going to give my standout. I believe he reached base 11 times in a row. Mm. That's pretty good. He went 8-for-10. What's the average there, Jake? 1, 2, go. Yes. 4 doubles, 2 runs driven in, 7 runs scored. 2 stolen bases for the two-dotter. Mm. You don't see too many two-dotters around there, but he two-dotted it. For the week, you mentioned Luis Matos. Junghoo Lee, sorry, man. That's freaking sucks. I really like watching you play. Big fan of yours. But like you mentioned, Luis Matos, 10-for-26, 3 doubles, 2 homers, 16 runs driven in for the week. 16, people. He's tied with 2013 Chris Davis with a C, not the K, for the most RBIs by a player in his first 6 games with a plate appearance. Of a season. That's since 1920. Rafael Devers went 8-for-29 with 5 homers. We mentioned that. 7th Boston player to homer in 5 straight games. The first since?
Yep. Ted
Who
Williams.
Do I want you to say? Who do I want you to say?
Justin Turner.
Bobby Dalbec.
Oh, Bobby.
In 2020, he did it. We've all tried to get 2020 out of our life and our memory.
2020, although, Bobby Dalbec hit 5 straight games with a homer.
Yeah, don't you remember that? He was like,
kind of. That was the season Jimmy likes to joke they had a ghost running the team.
How about Luke Raley going 11-for-24 during the week? 2 doubles, 2 homers, 5 runs driven in, 2 stolen bases, 2-2-2. I like that, Luke Raley. And then this is the list you want to be on. Mm. And you're going to like this, both you and Beavers. For the 2 weeks, Aaron freaking Judge. What's up, haters? 17-for-41. That's a .415 average. 7 doubles, 6 homers, 12 runs driven in, 12 runs scored, 12 walks. So he went with the 12-12-12, which is nice. Who's number 12 in Yankee lore?
That's the one that's been
a revolving door.
IKF.
Oh, really?
IKF.
That's Trent a pretty Grisham low number. Right, it hasn't been claimed for the Hall of Fame or the... Okay.
Rodriguez had it in his stint.
So 11 is next up, and they saved that for Volpe. So we'll see. And then 12 would be on deck.
There's fantasies on Twitter, people having Dominguez get it.
Yankees
stink.
Ugh.
It's the best.
We already talked about Yu Darvish. He went 3-0 in these 2 weeks. 19 innings pitched, 7 hits, 21 Ks. How about no earned runs? I'm not going to give up any earned runs. Is that okay with you guys? Do you know what his ERA is through those three?
Hey guys, sorry, file got corrupted here. That's on me. think I fixed it. Hopefully the rest of the episode it wasn't noticeable. It looked good on my end. Anyway, Matt Strom's ERA over that period is zero. Love you.
Strom has a scoreless streak of 18 and two-thirds consecutive innings and now has 30 strikeouts with one walk on the season. That, like, gets me going right there. When relievers don't walk, guys, I'm in.
Yeah.
And that's who's in Fuego.
Great stuff, Trev. And the good news is, from our best segment to our worst segment, the IL, there's really not much there. Max Muncy goes on the IL. Keaton Wynn, sure. Renjifo Soler's back. He mauled a couple balls. Jason Hayward, man, his body is just, like, super impressive. Like, watch him track down a couple balls. Byron Buxton and Grayrod. So, hey, a couple teams in the mix getting some reinforcements. Can we start everyone's week?
Awards!
Rock, paper, scissors, who goes first? Just rock, paper, go.
Rock, paper, go?
I saw you do rock and I still did it.
It's rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Anyways, I'm going to give out the Boring Brooms Award. Trev, I didn't, you know, sometimes I have an award planned. Sometimes I save my award to see what we missed, so I can hit something or highlight something. You know, we got...
What was it today?
We got tasty about the Yanks for a little bit. The Yank, oh, these are the best. Who's going to be number 12? There's been a clear best team in the National League this year that swept someone, and we didn't really talk about it. And it's the Philadelphia Phillies. And can I tell you what? That's a really good sign. That if you're the Phillies, it's May 20th, you're sweeping people, and we kind of shrug at it. That means you guys have been disgusting, and they have been. And I mentioned Cody Clemens before. Yes, Roger's son, which I think sometimes... So if you're like a famous athlete's kid and you're not that great, except Bronny, it's a little rude. He's going to break out. Like, Cody Clemens wasn't a top prospect. We saw him get some run, and it was like, oh, you know, he's kind of bad with the Tigers. In 11 games, he's been balling out this year, a 1.166 OPS. 28 years old, gives the Phillies a little juice. Alec Bohm had another 5 RBI game. The fighting Phils. And, Trev, you said the number when you did the standings. 5 games up on Atlanta? Okay. They're number one in runs scored. They are number one in starting pitching ERA. Pretty good formula.
I've been saying this a lot this year, but it's just kind of like making sense to me in the baseball world. Like, you just have to have good teams have guys step up for them, and Marsh and Bohm, the way they've been going, and Stott, the way he's been going, like, they're such a complete roster, man. I'm big time on the Phillies. I quite often reference their clubhouse as, like, I mean, it's awesome. It's a great place to be a player. You know, you got Nick Castellanos giving quotes. You got him and Kyle Gibson, when the whole Bohm thing went down, like, what they did for him. Like, they turned him from, like, someone that everyone fucking hated to saying the right thing. Say the right thing, kid. You're going to be loved. And now look what's happened with him. What's his name?
Okay.
On MLB Network, Mark DeRosa managed the WBC team, and he talked about Schwarber and JT Realmuto and Trey Turner, and, like, he's like, that's the clubhouse I'd want to be in. These guys are so professional. They understand everything, like, how to be big leaguers. And it emanates when you watch this team play. Like, they're legit.
I like hearing you say emanate. Yeah, and I mean, obviously they went out and got a lot of those guys you mentioned. But, dude, Bohm and Stott, go look at those dudes' pages and what they're doing. And that's before you get to, like, the whole pitching staff, which has been unreal. Ranger Suarez, Chris Sanchez, like, Nola Wheeler, obviously. Phillies are stacked, man. Phillies are stacked.
They're my World Series pick.
Okay.
I think.
I think, yeah, it's going to be, with all the excitement in Yankee Land, the thing I've been tapering my excitement. You temper your excitement.
Yeah.
You temper chocolate.
Oh, now we're talking. These teams are going to change so much. Like, the whole NL Central speech I get. Like, Paul Skeens. I don't know. Like injuries and just performance is going to change with so many teams and players that I'm excited and nervous for that. Who's your award going to, Trev?
Is Paul Skeens going to get a contract this year?
I think that man is just going to wait till free agency.
Why?
Because I think he's going to get super paid.
I would, if I was him, I would take my $300 million right now and I would just continue dating Livy Dunn and throwing fastballs down people's throats. And I'd
decent
be
life man. For him, huh?
I'd be a happy man. Okay. I don't really have a name for my award, and I don't really even have like a fun story to go with it. It's just something that happened that was very, very impressive. So this is like, I'm going to call this my, I like it long award.
Okay.
Okay. I have like a little something. I was thinking about doing this.
John
okay,
Hamm
yeah,
award?
John Hamm, Jack Flaherty, Trevor Plouffe. What do they have in common? When you work all day, and I haven't had a job that's made me do this necessarily. I'm talking like a, I used to clean pools with my dad.
Right.
All the time. And we went almost every single day of the summer when we weren't playing baseball, we were working with my dad. And there's just something about like a long day's work. When you're done, you just feel good about yourself. Like, damn, I just did it, man. And it's over now. And now I get to reap the benefits of a hard work day. I'm going to go home. You like eat a nice dinner. Like, I know a lot of people listening to this show, like they go through that quite often. Sometimes it's a pain in the ass and it sucks. But when you put the work in and then you get rewarded for it, I don't know if there's a better feeling.
I think it's part of the, I think that feeling, so many baseball fans have that. Cause when that 7 PM game starts, it's kind of the signal, like I've made it.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, I'm in the middle of my award, but here we are. Yeah, so like that a long day's work, you get rewarded. There's just something about that. We had a couple guys over the weekend go to work in their bats.
Okay.
William Contreras had an at bat against Justin Verlander. It went 13 pitches. Fastball, curveball, fastball, curveball, 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 fastball, changeup. Fastball, 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 fastball. Verlander was trying to gas him up there at the end of that at bat. And he fouled off 1, 2, 3, 4 four-seam fastballs in a row. Most of them were up and away in the strike zone. And then he gets one up over the middle of strike zone on that 13th pitch and crushes a 3-run homer to give the Brewers the lead. So he works that long at bat, gets it done, hits the homer. William Contreras, you're a fucking stud. I had to throw you in this award, but the real guy I wanted to give the award to is Jose Ramirez. Because he also had an at-bat against my Bailey Ober, the Nightmare. They went 12 pitches. And it went fastball, fastball, cutter, curve, cutter, changeup, cutter, fastball, fastball. Then he gets the changeup over the middle of the plate and deposits it. It's a 2-run homer. J-Ram does his thing. Do you know how many times he's done that this year?
Three
times. He's had a 10-plus pitch at bat end in a homer, dude.
Yeah.
Think about that. You're working. You're battling pitches. These at-bats are – you feel good about them pretty much either way it goes at the end of them, but you'd rather win them. It's like one of those – I don't know. He wins the at-bat against Ober. He's done it three times. And I think that he embodies, Jose Ramirez embodies those type of at-bats, dude. Like continuing to battle and to foul pitches off. Like he had, let's see, he fouled the fourth pitch off. He fouled the fifth pitch off. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, all foul balls till he finally got one in the middle of the strike zone and deposited it. And I don't know, man. I just think it's so cool. It was on his bobblehead night, putting in that work and then getting the reward at the end of it. is awesome, and you ruin the pitcher's day. Like Bailey Ober after that is like, fuck, man, I just wasted 13 pitches and I gave up a homer. Like it ruins pitchers' freaking days when you have a long at bat like that and you do it. So I wanted to give a shout out to him because, again, I feel like that is what he embodies there in Cleveland, man. Just putting the work in, putting the work in, putting the work in, and getting the reward three times this year. There's been six instances in the big leagues this year that's happened, Jake, and he has three of them. So snaps for Jose Ramirez and Williams Contreras. And Ty France, you also had a long at bat this weekend, but you didn't hit a homer. I think you had a double at the end of it.
Jose Ramirez, just a reminder, top 10 in MVP voting. Six of the last seven seasons. Currently off to like a bad start for him. He's got bold on his page. A bold that we've got over with analytics. It's still very important. Runs batted in.
Yeah.
Jose Ramirez leading the AL and runs batted in. And William Contreras, another stat I like that's a little old school. He leads the National League in runs scored. How about that? There's got to be some trivia there. When's the last time a catcher led the league in runs scored? I'll sick our nerds on it or comment
like that,
below.
Like that.
Chris Rose probably knows it off the top of his head.
More on Ramirez. He's had six homers in his career with 10 pitches or more. Like that's gangster stuff right there. Only one other Cleveland player has even two such homers. That's Casey Blake. And they're just two other big leaguers who have more than six such homers. And these guys are awesome grinder, a bat type guys. Todd Helton has eight and Paul Konerko has seven. Those are guys you want to be mentioned with.
Good ball players.
So shout out, Jose.
Trev.
And my dad.
Yeah.
I shouted my dad out, yeah.
Yeah. And your pool man days. Trevor, I love you.
Love you too.
Go watch Baseball Today with Trevor Plouffe. Go watch Ball and Play with BBD and Trevor Plouffe.
Yes.
Subscribe. We love you guys. We'll see you for the midweek. Little suck. It's a little suck. David Fletcher.
Whoops.
Went from cool knuckleball vid to different headlines.
David Fletcher. David Better.